Present topic is disease and pests of eerie and Muga silkworms. Like mulberry silkworms, eerie and Muga silkworms also prone to several virulent and infectious diseases and pests. The germ and symptom of the disease are more or less similar to those of mulberry silkworm diseases. Pebrine, flachery and grassery appear in this sector with varying degree of virulence and infection. However, many of these diseases rarely cause damage if worms are kept under hygienic condition and feed good quality leaves. Disease and pests of eerie silkworm. Pebrine, muscardine, flachery and grassery disease are the important diseases infect the eerie silkworm, and pest also damage the crops considerably. Pebrine disease. Eerie silkworm are subjected to pebrine disease exactly as their mulberry counterparts are. The causative organism of pebrine disease in eerie silkworms belong to the genus Nosema. The species, according to some, is not bombycin. It is reported that pebrine spores of mulberry do not cause pebrine in eerie worms or vice versa. Symptom of pebrine diseases. Eerie worms suffering from pebrine disease do not show any symptoms visible to naked eyes until the disease is far advanced. The disease larvae become more and more unequal in size, get sluggish and spin poor, flimsy cocoons. The moths emerges with difficulty and look deformed with small and scorched looking wings. They often become dull, black and lay eggs irregularly, many of which do not hatch at all. Methods and eliminate the pebrine diseases. The disease can, however, be eliminated through appropriate measures. These measures include through disinfection of rearing rooms and washing of rearing appliances with germicides, 2 to 4% formalin and 2% copper sulfate solution, avoidance of contamination and accumulation of dirt in the trays, etc. However, microscopical examination of moths and rejection of eggs laid by diseased ones are the best way to eliminate pebrine diseases from a lot. Next is muscardine disease. This disease, attack of muscardine, is not widespread in eerie sector. The causal agent for this is a fungus, Botrytis bassiana, which attack other caterpillars beside eerie silkworms. The fungus is reported to occur in association with other species of Botrytis. The worms attacked by muscardine becomes limp, loose, elastic, cease to move and die rapidly. After death, the bodies become rigid and mummified. They do not soften and very soon become rotten. In a few hours, they usually get covered with a white effervescence, as a result of which the body looks like a piece of chalk. Methods of eliminate muscardine diseases. If careful watch is kept on the worm under rearing and the disease detected at the very outset, the worms can be saved. If any worm develops muscardine, it should be carefully picked up and placed in disinfectant solution. The rest of the worms should be immediately transferred to a clean tray with the help of net. The discarded tray along with refuse should also be soaked in disinfectant water. However, other trays under rearing should not be stirred. Such cleaning should be continued till the fear of an outbreak of disappears. Burning a small quantity of sulfur and maintaining light sulfur fumes in the rearing house at the rate of 1 ounce of sulfur per 100 cubic yard of space. In addition to eliminating disease worms as described above, would be helpful in checking the progress of disease. However, the disease in eerie worms is not considered so very serious. And next disease is flachery disease. This disease generally occurs in grown-up worms which die mostly just before spinning cocoons. They show characteristic symptoms as, first they lose appetite, and do not eat well. Soon they look rather sicky, losing the natural shine and healthy appearance of the skin. The pellets of excreta become soft and stick to one another. The molds may not be shed properly as piece of them remain stuck up around the body. With the progress of the disease, the worm becomes sluggish and vomits a brownish liquid. The feces are soft and almost liquid, which soil the anus. Finally, the diseased worms get motionless, soft and discolored. Soon thereafter, the body starts turning into black in the middle, which later spreads over to the whole body, putrefying and turning it into a liquid state. By now, it starts emitting a bad and sicky odor, which is symptomatic only to flatulence. The disease and dead worms have a number of bacteria in their guts that causes fermentation and later putrefaction of the bodies. According to some, these bacteria are found in air, leaves and even in the guts of the healthy worms. But the present conclusion are that the disease is caused by some disturbance in the worm's metabolism or normal physiological function and in the already diseased guts. They are therefore not a cause but the consequence of the disease. However, this disease is not considered infectious. Method of eliminate flatulence: high temperature, high humidity and bad ventilation are the causes of the flatulence disease. Other causes instrumental for flatulence are dirty leaf, wet leaf, fermented leaf, coarse leaf, overfeeding and overcrowding, etc. To avoid the disease, fresh castor leaves should be given to the eerie worms and fluctuation in the temperature of the rearing room avoided. Grassery disease is caused due to excess of moisture in the castor leaves. Worms affected by this disease show distinctive symptoms, becoming a blotted in appearance, skin becoming somewhat shiny and yellowish in color, and the blood becoming turbid like pus instead of being clear as in ordinary worms. If the body fluid is examined under the microscope, it is found full of polyhedral crystalloids. They are also found in the different organs of the body. As they are brittle, they can be easily crushed by a little pressure on the cover slip on the glass slide. Casual agent. The casual agent of the disease, it is assumed, is some sort of a virus. The precautions to be taken are as follows: the proper ventilation in the rearing house, avoidance of tender leaf in the case of grown up worms, feeding young worms with tender leaf and mature worms with gradually matured leaf as they grow. Both P. ricini and P. cynthia behave characteristically diverse to the grassery disease, the former being immune and the latter receptive. Jassy 1964 failed to produce grassery in eerie worms both in oral feeding and inoculation. But the body of the moth frequently revealed the presence of abundant polyhedral corpuscles of identical nature of Bombax mori, reported by Wallader's 1940. Hence, it is considered that the eerie worms is a healthy carrier of virus. Steinhaus 1949 refers the Bole had experimentally infected the P. cynthia with the virus of silk jaundice. Jesse also observed sometimes after 1950, that is F2 generation of the cross of cynthia and ricini. Some worms died of grassery while the other developed normally. Pests of eerie silkworm. Eerie worms attacked by the parasite Tricholiga bombensis show a very prominent black scar at the point where the maggot enters the body of the caterpillar. When this parasite fly finds access to silkworm, it lays white oval egg on its body. The eggs are fairly large and can be seen by the naked eyes. Within 2 days, the maggot hatches out of the egg and at once penetrate into the body and start feeding off the egg, and at once penetration into the body and start feeding on its substances. The body wound of the caterpillar remains open and forms the entrance to a sort of chamber through in which maggot gets its supply of air. This prominent block scar is so characteristic that it alone is sufficient for diagnostic purpose. The maggot grows to full size within about a week. By that time, the eerie worm generally forms its cocoon and turns into pupae. The full-grown fly maggot makes its way out of the cocoon. Through the pupae drops on the floor and gets into the soil. In the soil, it contracts the body and turns into dark brown seed-like pupae. If the maggot happens to fall on the tray or on the hard floor, it pupates openly there. The adult fly develops in the pupal shell and wriggles out by pushing upon one end like a lid in the course of about 1 to 1.5 weeks. Each fly is capable of laying about 300 eggs and attacking up the same number of mature eerie worms. This fly pest, however, cannot do much damage to the eerie industry as the eerie cocoons are not reeled. Like other wild silkworms, eerie silkworm also infected by various pests such as fly wasps, canthiana bug, reedweed bug, ants, mantis, but the incidence is comparatively low. In the two regions of the temperate zones, the loss is higher in the eastern zone around 20 to 25% than in the western region recorded 10 to 15%. The tachinid fly causes considerable loss in the eastern region, while its incidence is almost negligible in the western region. Larvae infected during early instars die before spinning. In case of late infection, though the larvae form cocoons, the pupae succumb. The parasite maggots render the cocoons unreelable by making holes at several places on emergence. Other pests are not of serious concern in either of the region, as they collectively account for only 8% of the crop damage. Termia sericaria is another parasite of eerie silkworm reported by Japan. Fly pest can be controlled by preventing the emergence of adults from the maggots. Infected and dead larvae should be collected and burned. The infected cocoon should be stifled before the maggot emerge from them. Rats are frequent enemies of the eerie worms, cocoons and moths, and often do great damages. They must be trapped or poisoned. If they cannot be trapped, at least they can be poisoned by mixing plaster of Paris with flour. Lizards are another serious pest which destroy a large number of larvae during rearing period. They can be kept out of the rearing house without much difficulty. Next topic is disease and pests of Muga silkworms. The Muga silkworm are vulnerable to mainly to three types of diseases, namely bacteriosis, microsporidiosis, and occasionally virosis. Mycosis has not yet been detected, and pests also damage the crop considerably. Number one is bacteriosis. This bacteriosis is chain type of excreta, also known as flicid worm, and rectal protrusion have been reported in Muga silkworm. The symptoms are virtually similar to those of Antheria mileta. Very little is known about the causative agent. The disease accounts for a nearly 30% crop loss. The incidence is highest in the summer crop, and late instar worms are more susceptible. Unsuitable leaves and overcrowding induces the diseases. Next disease is microsporidiosis. As in other silkworms, the most striking symptom of microsporidiosis is the appearance of black spots on the body integument. However, In Muga silkworm, the spots are of two types, smaller in some cases and notably bigger in others. Worms with the later symptom, if they survive, molt 5 times instead of usual 4 times. The disease is caused by a microsporidian of the genus Nosema. The disease is transmitted both orally and transovarially, as well as by insect vector to some extent. The incidence of the disease is a sporadic nature, being less frequent during spring and autumns, but causing a 20% to 30% crop loss in the rainy season. Next is viruses. The viruses symptoms are almost identical to those in A. antheria mileta. During the early stage of the infection, the body of the larvae typically become flabby. A virus characterized by inclusion bodies is responsible for the disease. The inclusion bodies are slightly angular and quite different from those of Antheria mileta, Antheria prolii, Antheria perinei, and Antheria yamoi. Oral transmission takes place through contaminated food. Transovum transmission also occur, but there is no evidence of transovarial transmission. The loss due to viruses is almost negligible. Control measures of the disease: the rearing of the disease-free layings, the disinfection of eggs and equipment, and the maintenance of optimum population density are the major preventive measures against diseases. Since fluctuations in temperature during the embryonic stages has been observed to induce viruses, care should be taken to incubate the eggs at the optimum temperature. Apart from microscopic examination, the febrine disease can also be checked by exposing the cocoons to 33.8 degree centigrade and 55% to 65% relative humidity for 16 hours in the pre-pupal stage. The treatment of eggs with hot water about 40 degree centigrade for 30 minutes, 36 to 40 hours after oviposition also helps to control these diseases. Parasites and predators of Muga silkworms. As Muga silkworms are reared outdoors, they are subjected to attack by number of pests, namely tracheid flies such as S. sericariae, Tricholiga bombici, and Misera grandis have been reported to parasitize the larvae. The common predators of Antheria mileta, namely X predator, G. fusilata, H. bipapilla, and S. coleria also account for nearly 40% of crop damage. The biology and life cycle of S. sericariae is similar to that of B. zabina. Pests of Muga silkworms. Fly pest can be controlled by preventing the emergence of adults from the maggots. Infected and dead larvae should be collected and burned. The infected cocoon should be stifled before the maggot emerge from them. Like other wild silkworm, Muga also infected by various pests such as fly, wasp, canthicona bug, reeduweed bug, ants, and mantis. But the incidence is comparatively low. In the two regions of the temperate zones, the loss is higher in eastern zone 20% to 25% than in the western zone 10% to 15%. The tracheid fly causes considerable loss in the eastern region, while its incidence is almost negligible in the western region. Larvae infected during early instars die before spinning. In case of late infection, though the larvae form cocoons, the pupae succumb. The parasite maggots render the cocoons unreliable by making holes at several places on the emergence. Other pests are not of serious concern in either of the region, as they collectively account for only 8% to 10% of the crop damage. Stermia sericariae is another parasite of Muga silkworm reported by Japan. Thank you.